Hello and welcome to another episode of Gully Cricket to Bounce Wicket podcast. I'm your host Srinivas.
Hi everybody, this is Raja.
It's been less than a week since we have released an episode, but lots of things have happened in between. So fresh rumors on reasons for Virat Kohli leaving 2020 captaincy has come, and BCCI obviously, you know, will not bother to clarify any of those rumors. And Ashwin allegedly behaved disgracefully again in IPL. And India women started playing their pink ball test match against Australia down under. And when it comes to IPL, rich getting richer and poor getting poorer. Dream 11 is definitely not sponsoring this episode, and we are not going to say Kelo Dimag Se. Just I meant to say that, you know, teams at top of the table are performing well. You know, teams at bottom of the table kept on losing matches. So, Raja, have you been following cricket and how has your week been?
Pretty hectic, man. But before we start off, I'd like to congratulate you. Last week, both your predictions came true.
Yeah.
For Sunday's episode. Yeah.
Thanks to Harshal Patel.
Absolutely. RCB and CSK both pulling through. Great to see. Yeah. How have you been, man? Like, how was your weekend on?
Yeah, great. Of course, not many interesting matches, but a lot of interesting news and articles are coming out. It's fun spending some time in Twitter as well. So it's good. So let's get into the episode without any further delay. Let's look at India women playing Australia women in the pink ball test match. So India lost the toss. They have given a wonderful opening partnership of 93 runs. The match has started yesterday. Unfortunately, due to the weather condition, because of lightning and rains, of course, not many overs were played yesterday, and even today the same thing has happened. But Smriti Mandana has got a century, wonderful century. And India, like I mentioned, got an opening partnership of 93 runs. And at the end of the day today, of course, I think not much of game has been played post-dinner today. So India is at 276 for 5. So Raja, have you been, you know, following scores or watching India women's game?
Oh, a bit, man. A bit, actually. But, you know, like, every time these girls are playing test cricket and the manner in which they're performing, it's only getting us to one question as to why are they not playing more. You know, it's disgrace. You know, the actual disgraceful thing is that Indian women team is not playing too as many test matches as they deserve to play. The incredible to see, right? Girls, essentially, they're playing their first test match in Australia and putting up such a wonderful partnership. And it's not just that. There was a rain delay and then Smriti Mandana coming back and completing a century. Incredible and brilliant to see.
I don't know if you have noticed, Raja, Sneha Rana is not in the playing 11 after what?
Yeah. Correct.
So I could only think one reason for her not being in the team. Probably Deepthi Sharma is also a very similar kind of player, right? Both are right arm off spinners and, you know, middle order batters. So I think instead of Rajeshwari Gaikwad was playing today, probably as left arm orthodox spinner. So probably that could be the reason. That is the only reason that I can think of, really.
And even Deepthi Sharma is a left hand batter. So maybe that's the difference.
But really, Sneha Rana, I think she has got license now to play in any format, right? The way that she is playing right from the England series was amazing.
Yeah.
But what a shame, man. I think now 2 days are over. Only 100 overs have been played. And unfortunately, women's game are played for only 4 days. Now this test match is going to go for draw anyway, unless there is a miracle that is going to happen, right? Let's hope India will play a test match very soon. I would like
make
to
it see a series. I don't want a test match. I think it should be a series, you know, because they're up for it, right? They're up for the challenge and they're playing incredibly against England and against Australia as well. In both top of the line bowling attacks and just to eke out a brilliant draw in England just a few months back and today, you know, If arguably you could say that India has an upper hand at this point.
Yeah, definitely. Everyone would like to see a test series being played by India women. But obviously, like I mentioned just a few minutes back, BCCI, it's like Sometimes I feel BCCI is like a big boss, Raja. I mean, they will only say whatever they want to say, and they never respond to what people are asking, right? They never bother about what people are asking or whether to they can say something. They'll just announce whatever they want to announce.
And added to that, because you mentioned this, there's also this campaign for women's IPL, right? And the triangular exhibition games or whatever they called it, that was supposed to be a precursor to women's IPL, and this time around it's not even there.
Yeah,
we don't know. Maybe they'll schedule it at the last moment and make a difference, but at this point it's still not scheduled.
I don't think it's happening because with the COVID bio bubbles and all, I don't think it's happening at all. But we'd love to see women's IPL. And one good thing is, I think 4 or 5 players of India team got contracts in women's BBL.
The 100, even BBL also.
I mean, they are going to play after this. So I think 4 or 5 players have got contracts there. So it'll be fun to watch women's IPL as well. So let's hope,
And it's after, women doing so well at the 100 as well.
Yeah.
Jemima Rodrigues and the likes of them. They've done brilliantly there. Hey, come on, man. Give us the league and this.
Let's see. And let's get into IPL. We have a lot of matches to cover. And like you mentioned, we have discussed last time on Sunday, probably it was a doubleheader day, where when we were speaking, it was Kolkata's match that was happening. And I can only say one thing, man. Wherever there is Chennai, there will be drama, right? Chennai is full of drama and emotions and whatnot. Because see the match, because it was a good match, right? Kolkata got a good start, and then they went and they put 171 runs, right? I mean, Dinesh Karthik and Andrew Russell made sure they are reaching to a good total on that pitch, right? It was good competitive total, and it was nice to see, Dinesh Karthik firing after a lot of days, even in the first half of the IPL or in the previous IPL, he was not firing so much, and it was nice to see him firing. So let's see what happened in reply to KKR's 171. So Chennai, again, they have assessed the condition well. They have got a very good start, and as usual, Rituraj Gaikwad and Faf have put a top order score of 74, right? First wicket has fallen at score of 74, and then Moeen Ali has come in and he has played. So few wickets have, come here and there. Totally, I think at the end of 16th over, CSK were at 132 for 3, right? With Raina and Moeen Ali at the crease, and CSK need 40 runs from 4 overs, right? They have wickets in hand. So things were in control. From there, again, the whole drama has started. So third ball of 17th over, Russell gets injured while stopping a 4, and he gets off the field. So next ball, Moeen Ali gets out and Dhoni walks in. So with Russell not on the field, it's only 2 overs of spinners and 1 over for Prasidh Krishna has left. If Russell was there, only 1 over would have been spinner. So they have no other option. So Varun Chakravarti comes to ball 18th over. He gets Raina run out of the first ball and gets out Dhoni also in the same over, and he only gives 5 runs in the over, right? Now CSK need 26 from 2 overs and 2 new batsmen, right? Jadeja and Sam Curran both are new to the crease. So Jadeja hits 2 sixes and 2 fours and he scores 22 runs in a single over. So with only 4 runs to defend, now Sunil Narayan Tyagi, as called by, Harsha Vogle on the air, seeing what Karthik Tyagi did for RR in the match against PBKS. So he has 4 runs to defend, and he picks up Sam Curran in the first ball, and then a dot ball comes, right? Now equation comes to 4 balls from 4 runs. Now Shardul Thakur paddles a ball to fine leg and he gets 3 runs, and CSK now need only 1 run from 3 balls. Now Jadeja is on strike, and just remember, he has already scored 22 runs from the previous 6 balls he has faced, right? Because in the previous over, he has hit 2 fours and 2 sixes. He plays a dot ball and then he gets out. So now CSK need 1 run from 1 ball. So it was a whole mess, man. I mean, there no way CSK should come to this situation in the first place, and it is happening only because of CSK probably. So fortunately, Deepak Chahar just took a single of the final ball and he finished the match. That is one good thing that has happened, but I mean, it's a whole lot of drama. So your thoughts on this?
Unfortunately, I couldn't watch the game, but just reading about it and listening to people talk about it, it seemed like something that I would I do regret not being watching it live. But what a turnaround, you know, so many twists and turns, and there's another twist in the same match.
Let's move on to next match, Raja. It's match number 39, Bangalore versus Mumbai, right? I mean, obviously coming into the match, Mumbai wanted to win their first game in UAE, and RCB obviously would want to fix their position in the top three or top four as soon as possible. So obviously they would be wanting to win this match. Right. Even I think they also lost the first two matches in the UAE. So both the teams must be wanting to win the match. So RCB batted first. Kohli batted brilliantly. Padikkal got out early and Bharat has given good support to Virat Kohli. And once Kohli got out, Maxwell, I think he started slowly and then he picked up the pace and the kind of switch hits he was playing. I think for a lot of time, Mumbai were clueless for the field positions. Right. I think he has hit three sixes and six fours out of the nine boundary shots. I think at least four or five he would have hit switch shots. So Mumbai were absolutely clueless. They have tried their best to pull back the match. In fact, I think only four runs were scored of the last nine balls that Mumbai has bowled. So RCB has put 165 and it was anyone's game from there. Right. Mumbai is not a small team and they can really, you know, take away the match if it is 165. But let's see what Mumbai has done. So Mumbai has started really well. They know how to chase the targets of these kinds. They have good batting depth as well. So they have scored 56 runs in the power play. And once power play get over, Quinton de Kock gets out and very soon Rohit Sharma get out. Right? Rohit Sharma got out at the end of the 10th over and Mumbai were 79 for 2. They need probably another 80-85 runs from there on to win the match and it was all downfall. So if you want to give feedback for the Mumbai team, you can just call on the number 98573-00507. Those are the scores of the batsmen who have come after Quinton de Kock. So your thoughts on Mumbai's batting collapse, Raja?
What a shocker, right? It was unbelievable that such a powerful lineup just blew away. And all of it, during this particular story, I think we have to talk about Harshal Patel and how he pulled things back. What a brilliant cricketer he's turning out to be. And, you know, like with this kind of a skill set that he's developed, and this is his IPL, right? Every IPL, you have one or the other player who's putting their hands up. And everybody, even when the first leg of the IPL ended, everyone got to notice Harshal Patel. But once things moved to UAE, a lot of people wouldn't have given him that kind of credit. You know, they wouldn't have expected him to perform in this manner. And here he is literally turning matches on his own and snatching victory from the jaws of defeat kind of again and again and again. And if he keeps this up, I'm sure he'll turn out, you know, his performances are reminding me of what Dwayne Bravo did in his prime or even what he's doing right now. Great to see.
Definitely. Even in the first leg of IPL, many used to say all the wickets that Harshal Patel are getting useless wickets or crap wickets, tail-enders. He is lucky and all this, but him coming back and doing it in the, you know, second leg as well is commendable, right?
Correct.
And he is by far the best bowler in this season of the IPL. And his wickets tally was by far much ahead of the second bowler or third bowler competing for the purple cap, right?
Yeah.
And have you seen the small video of ABD's son? That is going around in the internet. So, ABD gets out probably in the final over or something in the fag end of the Bangalore innings. And his son just punches his hand to the table or something and he gets hurt. And his mother was concerned about it. So it was very nice video. And he was in the RCB jersey as well. So it was a really nice one. So again, I think this is a big defeat for Mumbai, right? I mean, they are losing at one end and then they have lost a lot of run rate as well because they got all out for 112. I mean, they lost match by 50 odd runs, which is huge margin, right?
Yeah.
So let's move on to next match, Raja. So it's Hyderabad versus Rajasthan. So I'm sure you would have followed this match irrespective of the other matches. So
correct.
Rajasthan has come for batting first. And I mean, Evan Lewis got out early. They got Jaiswal and Samson as pretty beautiful partnership. And then Lomrore has put up some runs in the end. And overall, I think 164 is a very good total. I don't say this is a bad total or something. Even I think SRH has bowled well and even they have tried to pull back, right? I think SRH has given only 11 runs of the last 2 overs that they have bowled.
Yeah.
So your thoughts on SRH batting and how they took the innings there?
Very clinical. I think this was one team performance that a lot of fans were hoping for. It did come very late in the season, but it's good that it did. First things to talk about is that Jason Roy has made his debut, and Warner. I don't know. I don't know if we'll see Warner in the Sunrisers jersey again.
No, I think Warner is at Hotel, right?
Yeah, he was at Hotel at that time, but I don't know the way Jason Roy performed. I don't think he'll come back.
No, I don't think he's coming back. And I have seen somewhere that he has replied to someone on Instagram saying for entire season, he's not coming to the ground. So, I mean, he's going to be at Hotel.
I don't know. I don't know what's going on at the back end of things. But coming back to the cricket, Saha and Jason Roy put up a really wonderful partnership. And it's once Saha fell, Jason Roy just took it to the another level. And Williamson, once he came in, both of them settled things and took SRH over the line. But during all this discussion, I do want to talk about Rajasthan Royals bowling. Do you think they need a specialist spinner? And again, we're seeing that they're going by with guys like Lomrore and Tevatia.
So, actually, they have got Shamshi, who is a very good bowler. But unfortunately, they took him in the first 2 matches or so and he went for runs and then they have dropped him. But he's actually too good a bowler and he has got truckload of wickets for South Africa. I think he's world number one T20 bowler right now. So, I mean, they can give him one more chance.
And even if you wanted an Indian spinner, you still have Shreyas Gopal in your ranks, right?
Yeah. And
so you could see that... The 6 overs of Tevatia and Lomrore, they went for plenty of runs. And where spinners have been dominant, or at least the go-to bowlers for teams around, I think this is somewhere Rajasthan is studying.
Definitely, Raja. I think it's point worth to note. But if we see SRH innings, I think it is a mixture of, you can say, New Zealand and England's game, right? Jason Roy at top firing and then Kane Williamson coming in the middle and then taking the match in his own style. So it was wonderful to chase and it all felt like it was a different SRH that was playing on that day, right? Yeah.
And the top order, and it's also an SRH template that a top one, that number 3 or 4 Indian player failing where Priyanka getting out in this first ball. But it was a good game, no doubt.
So let's move on to our next match, Raja. Let's move to Delhi Capitals versus Kolkata, match number 41. So it was very unlikely Delhi batting, right? Delhi batted first. They have got only 127, right? They are, of course, a bowling strong team, but definitely they are much better batting unit. Of course, Prithvi Shah was not part of the playing 11 due to some niggle and Steve Smith has come in. Of course, the team balance has been tweaked a bit because of that, but overall it was very unlikely of Delhi Capitals that they scored only 127 runs. But at the end of innings, where the interesting thing has happened, right? Between Ashwin and Ian Morgan. So what happened? It was very bizarre, man. Very, very bizarre. So Ashwin, I think, has put up a tweet today morning. I just want to read the tweet, or whoever has not followed, I just want to say what happened. So I think in the penultimate over or so, Ashwin and Rishabh Pant were batting. So when the ball has hit Rishabh Pant and it got deflected, they ran for one more run. In the subsequent over, when Ashwin got out, Team Saudi and Ian Morgan just went to Ashwin and said something that irritated him, and he got hyper, and then Dinesh Karthik has to come in between, and then he has to sort things out. So Ashwin has, and then this happened. Subsequently, at the end of the day's game, Dinesh Karthik comes to press meet, and then he says that, you know, Morgan felt it was a disgrace to do something like that when, you know, runs are coming, when ball is getting deflected, you know, hitting the batsman. So Ashwin gave a wonderful reply in the Twitter today morning. So I just want to read it. So I turned to run the moment I saw the fielder throw and did not know the ball had hit Rishabh, right? So when someone reached the first line, you'll think, okay, so Ashwin doesn't know that it has got deflected from Rishabh, so he has ran. So in second point, he's clarifying, will I run if I see it? Of course I will, and I am allowed to. So third point he says, and am I a disgrace like Morgan said I was? Of course not. I mean, it was too straight, right? It was too straight and many people couldn't take it. So your thoughts on this so-called spirit of the game, Raja?
It's unnecessary. It's very bizarre, you know, like I have another question here. Then for that matter, people should not run off overthrows at all.
Yeah.
Right. What is the point of that's also again, because the fielder made a mistake by making the throw. Am I allowed to run? Yeah. You know, when you look at then why are people supposed to bowl bouncers? That's against the spirit of the game. Why isn't the bowling easier? Why isn't it, you know, everything is a half volley? Why isn't everything a full toss and let the player smack it as far as he can? It's a sport with a certain rules, and the rules are laid out, right? You're not as if the rules are any rules are being broken or anything is being bent or even, you know, maligned. Everything is laid out as in the rule books. And if a run is allowed, then it's allowed. Yeah. I don't understand why every time Ashwin does something or this thing becomes like a huge ruckus, because I completely support his stance here. And I also support his stance when he ran out Josh Butler or anybody else.
I think he has put a series of tweets there. Even he mentioned that this one run can make or break
Absolutely.
A career of a player, right? One run can make a huge lot of difference. We all have seen what happened in
that's also
World Cup final.
Yeah.
And look where, who is talking, in fact.
Correct. Who is calling it a disgrace? That's the most hypocritical thing that we can come across. England has been a complete and a direct beneficiary of deflection. Okay, if somebody has the ball went and run off to the boundary. If say a fielder had stopped it, would Stokes not run? So it's all ridiculous, like comparing and making sense of, you know, they can come and say stuff like, oh, it's against the spirit of the game and when things are against them. But a lot of these players, these are the same people who whined when Jasprit Bumrah was bowling, bowling bouncers, or even when Zahir Khan was batting and somebody threw jelly beans. All of these are instances that England has done. We can go back and keep talking about spirit of the game, but if it is not against the rules, then everything is in the spirit of the game, because everything is laid out in.
I would say it's all up to the player, right? If he runs, he runs. If he doesn't run, if he wants to be good, he doesn't want to run, that's fine. That doesn't mean someone who runs will become bad and then, you know, breaking spirit of the game.
I have another. Okay, chalo, forget overthrows. Why are people running off base?
Yeah.
No, you haven't hit a run. Your bat hasn't touched the ball. Then are you allowed to take a run?
Yeah.
We can nitpick 10,000 things in one single game of cricket and how this is against the spirit of, against somebody's understanding of spirit of the game.
Yeah. In fact, I'm not sure whether you have followed, just in the afternoon, so Poonam Rao she just walked off the field. She just nicked it. Umpire did not give out. She just walked off the field. Then there was whole debate on Twitter saying, you know, she can, half the people say, you know, she followed spirit of the game. She just walked off. Half the people say, you know, it's a team game. How can you do that? You are betraying your team. That's fine, man. That she decides to walk off.
You know what? Ultimately, you know, we can have billions of opinions, right? Every cricket player every cricket fan can have an opinion. But ultimately, there are 22 people on the field, or maybe you can say 13 people on the field at one point. What they decide to do, that is right.
Right.
Correct. What they're right as per their understanding of their game. And what they're doing is absolutely acceptable if it's not being rude or hurtful or against with the values, not values, I would say, it's going against the rules of the game. Whatever they're deciding to do, that, you know, who are the gatekeepers of this spirit of cricket? They're the players. And if a player is playing according to that, they're keeping up the spirit of the game. It's not... And unless it is blatant cheating, you know, if something is evidently wrong and they're cheating and...
there is a match referee only watching these things, right?
Correct.
Match referee watching only these kinds of things and he has no other job to do, literally.
Correct. So what is the point of... And okay, forget careers being made on a single run or not. This is a very weird Sharjah ground, right? The average score has been around 130. Here, one run will make a difference.
Definitely.
Right? So why not?
And even even at the end of a day, a small difference in run rate can make them qualify, right? KKR qualify or anything can happen.
Yeah. So I definitely don't agree with this. And it's nice that it's very strange that the longest conversation we've had about any single topic is of outside the game. Yeah.
IPL is fun. I mean, by default and with Ashwin, it's more fun, isn't it?
Yeah. And IPL drama is even more fun. Everything involved with the back room or whatever is going on with the players, it's incredible to see.
Yeah. So let's see what KKR has done in reply to the DC score of 127. I think I would say they have completed it quite comfortably. So they have finished the match in 18.2 overs. At some point, it looked like match was going close, but Sunil Narayan has ensured that, you know, it has been completed well ahead of time. He has scored 21 runs of the 10 balls. He came as lower middle order batsman, but he played very good innings there and he finished the match early.
Yeah, I think it's very clear what you said. I couldn't put it any better.
And just not tricky, to forget.
Tricky chase, but well done. And right when maybe DC thought that they had an opportunity to get back into the game, Sunil Narayan came and took that opportunity away.
And just not to forget, and this is the same Ian Morgan who was taking quotes from team analysts sitting in the dugout, right? Team analyst was displaying some quote. This is the same Ian Morgan and it has just happened two matches before. And it has happened in the first leg as well. So it was quite funny that Ian Morgan coming and saying this is the disgrace. And this is IPL, man, and in between overs, they can easily pass the message to team in the ground. I don't know what sort of codes or what sort of additional support teams required in middle of the over. I don't know.
And it's cricket. Like, you can always catch somebody, some player can just catch their hamstring and get as many breaks as they want unless it's very strange. And yeah, but that's what I mean. Like, it's a very hypocritical stance. And I hope it's also something that Morgan reflects on and just moves on from it.
Yeah. So let's move on first. So next match is match number 42, Mumbai versus Punjab. So Punjab has come to batting first and they have put 135. Again, not a great score. This is in Abu Dhabi as well, not in Sharjah. And I think they have left a lot of runs there because we have seen many times whenever opening batsman of Punjab fails, mostly they'll fail. And in this match, Mayank has picked an eagle and Mayank was not playing. And I'll stop saying it's a surprise selection from PBKS, right? They'll keep giving shocks and surprises to everyone. I couldn't understand when Mayank was not playing, why Gale was not opening the match, man. I mean, anyone in this world, why do they think Gale should not get a power play, right? By default, if you ask me, Rahul and Gale should open. One left-right combination, Gale will get power play. I mean, those field restrictions, he can hit those fours and sixes, especially when Mayank is a good player of spin, right? So he can come and attack in the middle overs. So that could be one batting strategy, but they are going for a well-tested and tried Rahul and Mayank opening. That's fair. So when Mayank was not playing, still they went with Gale at number three. They got Mandeep into the team and still they are not playing Shah Rukh Khan, who has played brilliantly in the first half. I myself has put a lot of time and such jokes on Preeti Zinta and Shah Rukh Khan, and they are not even giving me chance this time to do that. So your thoughts on these strange selections and how Punjab is working?
I think I have to correct myself. Last time I thought the close win would give them some kind of confidence in their lineup and they would not make too many bizarre changes. But I couldn't agree more. If you had someone like Chris Gayle in your lineup and who can be as devastating. And this is somebody, he's older or whatever it is, still playing for West Indies. This is the same guy who will open for West Indies probably in the next 2-3 weeks. So very strange that Punjab went that way. And I think once the top three fell, Aidan Markham try to solidify put some kind of stability into the Punjab innings and maybe a bit of support from Deepak Hooda too. But as you said, it's a very underwhelming score, 135 for 6.
So let's see what Mumbai Indians has done in reply to PBK's target. So again, this match, unfortunately, Rohit Sharma got out quickly and Surya Kumar Yadav got out on the first ball. I don't know, man. I'm really worried because India's top order for the World Cup is a lot dependent on Surya Kumar Yadav, right? Because he was solely selected on the basis of his aggressive batting. And just thinking that the World Cup is going to be played in the same pitches, right? Same grounds in less than 3 weeks of time or in 3-4 weeks of time is scary, really. I really hope he'll come good in the balance matches. And Sky got out early and Saurabh Tiwari got into the match. They have dropped Ishan Kishan, right?
That's also a topic of discussion, yeah.
Yeah, he was really struggling. I think it's good for him as well. He can just sit out maybe two matches or so and just see how things are happening and what is the mistake that is there on his side. Because it's very strange. He haven't played well in the first half of IPL as well. He played well in the Sri Lanka series in between. And he is not playing well in the second half of IPL. And it is not his first IPL to think that, that fear of playing in IPL or things are working on his mind. There is nothing like that. I couldn't really understand reason for his failure. But Saurabh Tiwari, I think he played well in the few chances that he has got as well. And in this innings as well. And finally, I'm happy to see Hardik Pandya getting some runs under his belt.
Yeah,
not bowling. And in the previous matches as well, he was not playing well. And even in this match, the scorecard may say he got 40 of, 30 balls. But it was not true, actually. I think he got maybe a 4 and 6 in the end of the innings. And then he got the strike rate of 133. But whatever it is, I'm really happy to see Hardik Pandya getting runs there. And they finished the match in 19th over. So, your thoughts on Mumbai's batting, Raja?
My good summarization of what happened. I thought they might be a little bit of wobbles once Rohit fell early and Surya fell early. But I think Saurabh Tiwari coming in place of Ishan Kishan, I think that was the right move at the right time because he was the person who took on the bowlers. We could talk about, as you said, Hardik Pandya making 40 of 30, but even he struggled for, you could say, almost 55 or 60% of the innings Hardik didn't seem as confident. And multiple times we had seen Mohammad Shami sticking to his plan of bowling outside off and back of the length, pacey balls to Hardik Pandya, and he was getting visibly frustrated. I don't know if you remember that. He was playing and missing, and he started screaming out. So from that mind space, getting that win was very important. And once Tiwari fell, the OG, Kyron Pollard, joined his best pal or whatever and then finished up things. So pretty clinical in the way they went it. Very Mumbai performance in the second half of the game, but second half of the batting. But credit to Punjab for making things very difficult. We have to talk about, again, Ashdeep Singh has been brilliant. Ravi Bushnoi has been incredible.
Amazing. I think he is going to get India call-up very soon.
Yeah. I hope he does, because these guys are really, really bowling very well.
So let's move on to next match, Raja.
And tough loss for Punjab. Yeah.
Yeah. That's the standard line for them in the whole season, right? So they'll get all close matches and then they'll find different ways to lose a match. So this time they find a way to give Mumbai batsmen some form, right? They've made sure, you know, Mumbai batsmen are getting some runs under their belt. And
they're your favorite punching bag, is what I can say. I don't know.
So let's hope Mumbai will take momentum from this match going into the series further, because it is going to be very crucial for them for the balance three matches. So let's move on to match number 43, Rajasthan versus Bangalore. So Rajasthan came to batting first. So again, Evan Lewis was devastative, and SSV Jaiswal has been consistent for the past 3-4 matches, right? He was getting 30s, 40s.
Correct.
And then Sanju Samson got out early in this match, and from there was no one to really pick from there. At end of 11th over, or at the end of 10th over or 11th over, they were at 100 runs, right? It all looked like they were going to score 200 runs. And from there on, they lost the wickets. And I think in the end of 13th over, they took strategic timeout. And coming back from the strategic timeout, Shahbaz Ahmad has bowled and he picked up 2 wickets in the same over. That really has put brakes on Rajasthan innings. From there, they ended at hardly 149. It's a new pitch. It's actually in matches happened in Dubai. It's a new pitch and it was looking good. So I was thinking, at least even if they couldn't reach 200, I was thinking they'll reach 180, 190, and it is going to be an interesting match. But again, Rajasthan has done what Rajasthan has been doing for many seasons now. So they have literally blown the chances that they have. And in reply, RCB has been absolutely amazing, right? I mean, you can say every top order batsman has got those 20, 30, 40 runs that they needed. And they have really finished the match in the 17th over, thanks to Maxwell. I think he has scored 22 runs in a single over. I know it was going run a ball kind of thing in the last 4 or 5 overs. And then I thought, okay, I'll just go to bed and I'll adjust everything. I just locked my house and then I just came back and I switched on the TV again. And then the match was over, actually. In the probably 16th or 17th over, he has hit 20 runs or something like that and then finished the match. So your thoughts on this match, Raja?
Record in chief, I would say Harshal Patel for the bowling and just to put on that brakes and cause that collapse. And coming to RCB's response and how it panned out, a bit of inexperience, I think, Sanju Samson's end as well. When Bharat and Maxwell were putting on that partnership, instead and throughout the match, you could see that Chetan Zakaria and Mustafizur Rahman have been their best bowlers. Both of them have not finished their spells. Both of them ended up with only 3-3 overs each. I think maybe just pulling them back and, you know, waiting for them to finish the innings was a bad idea. getting them in between to take a wicket or two, and not relying too much on guys like Lomror and Parag and Tevatia to put a halt on the run scoring. I think that's also something that he needs to reflect on. Again, Chris Morris had a very bad game. So Karthik Tyagi also went for a lot of runs. But while giving credit to Glenn Maxwell for finishing it, we have to give even more credit to Sikar Bharat. Very mature innings. I think he was very very well composed in his mind. Once the first wicket partnership fell, and I think Kohli also got out within a span of 8-10 runs, I think. From that point, he was he didn't give up, and he started rotating the strike when he needed, taking on the bowlers when he needed to. I think this will give him a lot of confidence, and also RCB going forward, giving him more opportunities as the Indian wicketkeeper batsman.
Definitely, I think they have tried different people at number three in the first half. They have tried Rajat Patidar, they have tried Shahbaz Ahmed, they have tried Washington Sundar there. They were not successful and they were not happy, right? They have kept on changing people there. But fortunately, they have got Sikar Bharat in this half of the IPL, and I think they are going to continue with this combination. At least they will definitely not look to tweak anyone in the top five.
Yeah.
Raja, with these things in the context, so RCB, Delhi and CSK are short shot qualified, right? Of course, maybe not on paper, but of course, these three teams are confirmed.
Most likely.
So there is one more team that has chance to take those fourth place. And I think two teams I have in mind, probably KKR and Mumbai Indians have real good chance or has the capability or the team that can do that. So your pick between KKR and MI?
My heart wants to go with KKR, but I know my mind is saying MI. only because I think they'll pull through. Yeah, I think they've got the experience to make crunch matches count. And I think MI will pull through. Yeah.
No, I would want to say MI, but really things are looking bad for them. Even run rate is not really supporting them. On the other hand, KKR had very good run rate, right? They are already in plus 0.3. So I really hope we are going to get an exciting next three matches or four matches for the all the teams. And let's hope we'll get a good matches this weekend as well. Let's catch up on probably next episode, maybe with another 5 or 6 matches that we are going to see in next couple of days. So that's all for today's episode, guys. Please do subscribe to our YouTube channel and do leave your review on Apple Podcast and follow us on Spotify and Google Podcasts to get notified when we release a new episode. Thanks for tuning in. Stay tuned for more such interesting episodes. Bye-bye.